Students, today we will learn how a steam turbine works, and we will learn about a particular type of turbine, that is impulse turbine with axial flow of steam. Now first of all we get a review about Rankine cycle. In Rankine cycle we know that there are four elements, that is the boiler, the turbine, the condenser and the pump. So what is happening in the boiler? In the boiler, liquid water is converted into high pressure steam. This high pressure steam is then entering inside the turbine and it is falling over the blades of the turbine. So by this way the blades are being pushed and the shaft rotates. After doing work, the steam is coming out and fed to the condenser. In the condenser, the steam is losing heat and again becoming liquid water, and this liquid water is then again fed to the boiler. By this way the cycle completes and it is called Rankine cycle. So in this lecture we will learn that how a steam turbine works, means between the boiler and the condenser the part is the turbine. Now first of all it should be noted that what is an impulse turbine. An impulse turbine is that turbine in which the kinetic energy of steam is used to run the shaft of the turbine. Means what is happening actually, the high pressure steam is passed through a nozzle, and in the nozzle the design is so made that the pressure of steam falls and the velocity of steam increases. Because pressure is a form of energy, so when pressure will drop then energy will drop, so the pressure energy will transform into the kinetic energy of steam. So this high velocity steam is then made to fall over the blades of the turbine. So by this way this blades gets a push in tangential direction, and this push is then transferred to the shaft of the turbine and the shaft rotates. So in case of impulse turbine it is to be known that only the kinetic energy of steam is utilized to run the blades. Second thing is, over the moving blades the pressure of steam doesn't changes. So two things are there for impulse turbine, that is only the kinetic energy of steam is used to run the blades. Second thing is, there is no pressure drop of steam over the blades. Now let us see a principal diagram of steam turbine, axial flow steam turbine. We can see there are three basic components, that is the casing, the shaft and the nozzles. So what is axial flow? Actually what is happening, after coming out from the nozzle the steam is going to fall over the blades of the turbine, but the direction of flow of steam is parallel to the direction of axis of rotation of the shaft. This is why it is called as axial flow turbine. The steam flows in the parallel direction of the shaft direction. So we can see the cut section, that how from the nozzle the steam is coming out. We can see the steam is shown in blue, that from the nozzle the steam is coming out and gliding over the blades. So what is happening, the blades are getting a push in tangential direction. So since the blades are being connected to the shaft, so the shaft rotates in clockwise direction. So what is happening, steam from the boiler is coming and entering inside the nozzle. In the nozzle the pressure of steam falls and the velocity of steam increases, so it increases its kinetic energy, and this steam is then made to fall over the blades. So over the blade the steam is gliding over, giving the push, and those blades are connected to the shaft, so shaft is rotating in the direction corresponding to the direction of the movement of blades. So we summarize once again, steam is coming, entering inside the nozzle, the pressure of steam is falling, the kinetic energy of steam is increasing, this high velocity steam is falling over the blades are getting a force, so they are being pushed, and by this way it rotates the shaft of the turbine. Now let us learn that how the steam glides over the blades. For simplicity we are showing that there is a blade which is moving in upward direction with velocity u. So we can see in the diagram that there is a nozzle, and from the nozzle the steam is coming out and gliding over the inner surface of the blades, and then ultimately it is exiting from the blade, and then flown to the condenser. So from the boiler the steam is coming, and between 1 and 2, between point 1 and 2 of nozzle, the pressure of steam falls. On the same behalf the velocity increases. We can see that at point 1 the velocity of steam is minimum, that is at point A. We can see by the blue line, the blue line is showing the velocity of the steam. Similarly at point 1 the pressure of steam is at point E. So at point 1 the pressure is maximum but velocity of steam is minimum. So what is happening between point 1 and 2, the pressure falls from E to F, and since pressure falls so the velocity increases from A to B. So at point F, that is corresponding to the point 2 of nozzle, the velocity of the steam is at its maximum but the pressure goes to minimum. From point B the steam is entering to the blade to glide over the blade. So what is happening, the kinetic energy of steam is then transferred to the blade. So what is happening, since the energy is being transferred continuously with the glide of the steam over the blade, so between point B and C the velocity of steam is continuously decreasing. Why so? Because we know that kinetic energy is being consumed by the blade for developing energy over the blade. So what is happening, between point B and C the velocity of steam is falling, because kinetic energy of steam is falling, it is transferred to move the blade. But the pressure of steam remains same between point F and G. We can see up to the exit the pressure remains same. Why it is so? Because we know that over impulse turbine blades the pressure doesn't changes, only the kinetic energy of steam is transferred to the blade. So we can see, since the steam is gliding over the blade's inner surface and the blade is getting a push in upward direction, so in actual condition the blade is moving in tangential direction and it is connected to the shaft of the turbine. This push converts into the torque over the shaft and it rotates the shaft. So once again we summarize that between point 1 and 2 the pressure of steam is made to fall, and on the same behalf the kinetic energy of the steam is increasing. We can see that between point E and F in the graph the pressure is falling, and between point A and B the velocity is increasing. This high velocity steam having kinetic energy is gliding over the surface of the blade. This kinetic energy is transferred to move the blade. So since the kinetic energy is transferred continuously in the glide, so continuously the velocity of steam is falling between point B and C, and ultimately it is exiting out with pressure G and with exit velocity, that is C. Now a question arises that how much force will be applied on the blade by the flow of steam. Steam is flowing with some mass flow rate and it is striking with the blade and gliding over the inner surface of the blade, which is imparting a force, and by that force only the shaft is moving. For knowing how much force is applied over the blade, first of all we will understand that what is Newton's second law of motion. We know that momentum of a particle is given by the product of mass of the particle and the velocity of the particle. Suppose a particle is of mass m and moving with velocity v1, and suppose after some time its velocity changes to v2, then the initial momentum will be mv1 and the final momentum will be mv2, because mass will not change, only velocity is changing. So the change in momentum will be given by the final momentum minus initial momentum, that is equals to mv2 minus mv1. So the Newton's second law of motion says that force applied over any body is given by the rate of change of momentum with respect to time. Means F is equals to dp over dt, where dp is the change in momentum of the particle and dt is the time taken for change in momentum. For example, we can see that there is a plate and there is a ball of mass 2 kg and which is moving to collide with the plate with the velocity 10 meter per second. So its initial momentum is 2 into 10, that is equals to 20 kg meter per second. After colliding, it is coming back with minus 10 meter per second. So the final momentum is equals to 2 into minus 10, that is equals to minus 20 kg meter per second. So the net change in momentum is equals to P2 minus P1, that is equals to minus 20 minus 20, that is equals to minus 40 kg meter per second. Now in case the time taken for this change in momentum, means in the collision, is 0.1 second, suppose it is assumed, then the force applied on the plate will be equals to rate of change of momentum with respect to time, that is equals to minus 40 upon 0.1, that is minus 400 newtons. Means we summarize that rate of change of momentum is equals to the applied force. Now we will take an example in which a ball is going to strike the plate making some angle with horizontal. We can see that a ball of mass m with velocity v1 is going to strike the plate with an angle theta 1 with horizontal. After striking, it is rebounding back with velocity v2 and angle theta 2 with horizontal. In such a case, we can resolve the velocity vector of ball in two mutually perpendicular components. The horizontal component of velocity of ball before striking the plate will be v1 cos theta 1, and the vertical component for the same case will be v1 sin theta 1. Similarly, the horizontal component of ball after striking the plate will be minus v2 cos theta 2. It is negative sign because by this time the ball is moving in opposite direction to that of the direction of ball before striking the plate. Hence it will be negative. Similarly, the vertical component of velocity of ball after striking will be v2 sin theta 2. Suppose time taken for change in momentum for this process is dt, then the force applied over the plate in horizontal direction, that is FH, will be horizontal change in momentum of ball with respect to time, which is equals to minus mv2 cos theta 2 minus mv1 cos theta 1 upon dt. Similarly, the vertical force FV applied over the plate will be vertical change in momentum per unit time, that is equals to mv2 sin theta 2 minus mv1 sin theta 1 upon dt. So we summarize that in case the ball is going to strike the plate with making some angle, then the velocity of the ball can be resolved in two mutually perpendicular direction, one horizontal and one vertical. So the force applied over the plate is also in two mutually perpendicular direction, one horizontal and one vertical. The horizontal force applied over the plate is equals to the horizontal change in momentum per unit time. Similarly, the vertical force applied over the plate is equals to the vertical change in momentum per unit time. In earlier example, we took the case in which the ball is colliding with a stationary plate. But what will happen in case the plate is also moving in the direction of motion of ball? In this picture, we can see that in the first case, the ball is there which is moving with velocity vb and it is colliding with a stationary plate. In such a case, the ball will revert back with the same velocity, but the direction will be opposite to that of the direction of collision of ball with the plate. We can see the ball is moving with 5 meter per second and simply colliding with the plate and reverting back with minus 5 meter per second. But why it is so that magnitude is not changing, only direction is changing? It is because suppose the ball is having kinetic energy E, it is striking with the plate. Since its kinetic energy is not transferred to the plate because plate is not moving, in case the kinetic energy is transferred to the plate, then it will move. In such case, the kinetic energy of ball will reduce, but plate is not allowed to move, so the kinetic energy of the ball will be conserved and the ball will revert back with the same velocity, but the direction is opposite to that of the colliding direction. Now in second case, we are seeing that plate is also moving with velocity Vp in the direction of the movement of the ball. In such a case, what we will consider, we have to take the relative velocity of ball with respect to the plate. So suppose the ball is moving with 5 meter per second and in the same direction the plate is moving with 3 meter per second. So what we have to consider, the ball is going to strike with the plate with the relative velocity, that is equals to 5 minus 3, that is equals to 2 meter per second. It is what the apparent velocity by which the ball is going to collide with the plate. So we can consider that plate is stationary, but the ball is colliding with the plate with 2 meter per second. So in case the plate is also moving and ball is also moving in the same direction, then we have to take the relative velocity of the ball, and we can consider the plate is stationary. So apparently it will strike, the ball will strike with the plate with the apparent velocity, that is equals to Vb minus Vp. So in such a case, the plate is taken as a stationary, so the ball will revert back with the same relative velocity but in opposite direction. So the velocity after collision will be minus Vb minus Vp, that is equals to minus 2 meter per second. So what will be the force applied on the plate? Simply it is the change in momentum. Initial momentum equals to m Vb minus Vp, and final momentum will be minus m Vb minus Vp. So it is equals to the change in momentum of the ball upon the net time taken by the ball in collision. So again we summarize that in case the plate, the striking surface is not moving, then the striking body, that is the ball, will strike and simply reverse back with the same velocity. Because the kinetic energy is not transferred to the plate, and in this condition we are considering that there is no loss occurred due to friction and any other loss. In case plate is also moving, the striking surface is also moving in the direction of the movement of the colliding particle. In such a case, we will consider that the plate is stationary and the ball is going to strike with the plate with the relative velocity, that is equals to the velocity of the particle. Here we are taken Vb as the velocity of the ball minus the velocity of the moving surface, that is the plate, that is Vp. And in case we are taking the relative velocity, then we can consider that the plate is stationary and ball is going to collide with the relative velocity. So with same relative velocity it will revert back. Now in this picture what we see, that a stream is a continued flow of particles. That is, suppose it is a water jet, we can see the blue line. The blue is a stream, which may be of water, may be of steam or any other liquid or fluid. So a stream is flowing and colliding with the blade and then gliding and reverting back, we can see. Suppose the mass flow rate of the stream is m dot in kg per second, means it is the rate of the mass which is striking with the blade and then gliding and reverting back. So in 1 second, the amount of fluid which will strike with the plate will be m dot. So the momentum, initial momentum of the fluid will be Vs into m dot. Similarly, it is striking and reverting back with velocity minus Vs. In such a case, the final momentum will be equals to minus m dot Vs. Now net change in momentum will be equals to the final momentum minus initial momentum. So that is equals to minus 2 m dot Vs. This is what the amount of force which is applied over the blade, because we are already talking about the momentum change in 1 second, because mass flow rate is m dot and it is the amount of fluid which is going to strike with the blade in 1 second. So in 1 second only it is reverting back. So the net change in momentum in 1 second is what the applied force, because we know that force equals to rate of change of momentum per unit time. So in such a case, the force applied on the blade will be equals to minus 2 m dot Vs. Vs is the velocity of the stream which is striking with the plate. Now we will find out the force and work done in case a stream is striking the blade with velocity c1 making an angle a1 with horizontal. We can see the picture. We can see a stream with velocity c1 is moving, making an angle a1 with horizontal. It is gliding over the inner surface of the blade and then leaving the blade from the other end. The blade is also moving with velocity u in the direction parallel to the horizontal component of the stream velocity. Now we can resolve the velocity vector of a stream into two components, that is the horizontal and vertical. The horizontal component of the stream velocity will be equals to BC, which is equals to C1 cos A1, and the vertical component will be C1 sin A1, which is equals to vector AB. We can see in the velocity triangle at the inlet. But we can see that blade is also moving with velocity u in the direction of horizontal component of stream velocity. Thus, horizontally, the stream will not strike the blade with velocity c1 cos a1, but it will strike the blade horizontally with apparent or relative velocity, that is equals to c1 cos a1 minus u. Thus, in the picture, we can see that horizontal component of stream is c1 cos a1, that is equals to bc, but apparent or relative velocity of stream in horizontal direction will be equals to vector bc minus u, that is equals to c1 cos a1 minus u, that is equals to bd. Here bd is smaller than bc, we can see, because out of bc some part is been deducted, that is the horizontal velocity of the blade. Thus, although the stream is moving with velocity c1 making an angle a1 with horizontal, but apparently the velocity vector which is striking the blade will be r1, that is equals to vector ab plus vector bd. Thus, we can consider the velocity vector which is striking the blade inlet will be r1, which is called as relative velocity of the stream with respect to that of blade. Now, in case we are considering relative velocity, therefore we can consider that stream is moving with velocity r1 making an angle b1 with horizontal, and the blade can be considered stationary. Now, suppose the stream is coming out from the other end of the blade with velocity r2 making an angle b2 with horizontal. In case there is no loss occurred while gliding of stream through the inner surface of blade, then ideally r1 equals to r2. Now, the horizontal component of the exit relative velocity of the stream will be equals to minus r2 cos b2. Similarly, the vertical component of exit relative velocity will be r2 sin b2. Now, how to find out r1 and b1? It is simple. We can see by Pythagoras theorem r1 is equals to root of ab square plus bd square, but bd is equals to c1 cos a1 minus u, and ab equals to c1 sin a1. Thus, r1 is equals to root of c1 cos a1 minus u whole square plus c1 sin a1 whole square. Now, what will be v1? It is also simple. We can see that tan of angle b1 is equals to ab by bd, because we know tan theta is equals to perpendicular upon base. Thus, tan b1 equals to c1 sin a1 upon c1 cos a1 minus u. Thus, b1 is equals to tan inverse of c1 sin a1 upon c1 cos a1 minus u. Now, the exit relative velocity of the stream is equals to r2, which is ideally equal to r1. Now, the horizontal component of exit relative velocity will be r2 cos b2, and the vertical component of the exit relative velocity will be r2 sin b2. Thus, in case the stream is moving with mass flow rate of m dot kg per second, then for 1 second the amount of steam which is striking with the blade will be m. Thus, the initial horizontal momentum of the stream will be m dot r1 cos b1, and the final horizontal momentum will be minus m dot r2 cos b2. Thus, in 1 second, the net change in momentum will be minus m dot r1 cos b2 minus m dot r1 cos b1, which is equals to horizontal force applied over the blade, because force is equals to the rate of change of momentum per second. Thus, the horizontal force applied over the blade is equals to m dot r2 cos b2 plus m dot r1 cos b1. In case we are only considering the magnitude, not the direction, means we are eliminating the negative sign because we are only considering the magnitude of the force applied. Now, what will the power developed over the blade in horizontal direction? It is also simple. We know that power is equals to force into velocity. Thus, the net force applied over the blade into the velocity of the blade will be the power developed. Now, what will be the blade efficiency for this process? We know definition of efficiency is equals to desired effect upon input. We know that our desired effect here is the power developed over the blade. But what is the input over the blade? We know that steam is coming from any nozzle, so it is having some kinetic energy. So the input over the blade is equals to the kinetic energy of the stream. Thus, the efficiency will be the net power developed over the blade in horizontal direction on the behalf of net kinetic energy of the stream striking with the inlet of blade in 1 second. That is equals to power P over half m dot c1 square, that is equals to 2p by m dot c1 square. Here it is to be noted that for the case of impulse turbine, b2 is equals to b1, and for making b2 equals to b1, physically the profile of blade is accordingly made. Now, one more thing is there, that it is to be noted that the force applied in the horizontal direction of the blade is actually in the tangential direction of the rotor, because this component is what moving the shaft of the blade. So actually this is the tangential component which is trying to rotate the shaft. The force developed in vertical direction is the axial force over the turbine shaft, because the direction, the vertical component is what acting along the axis of the turbine. So this force is being bearded by the bearings of the turbine. Up to this point we were talking about the horizontal force developed over the blade, but since it is having two components, the steam velocity is having two components, therefore it will also impart a force over the blade in vertical direction. So what will be the force developed in the axial direction? Simple, it is again by Newton's second law of motion, that is equals to change in momentum of the steam in axial direction. So therefore we know that the axial component at inlet of the blade is equals to AB, that is equals to R1 sin beta 1. Similarly, the axial component or the vertical component at the outlet of the blade is equals to vector FE, that is equals to R2 sin B2. Then simply the change in momentum in axial direction of movement of steam is what the axial force developed, which is given by the expression we can see, that is equals to m dot bracket r1 sin b1 minus r2 sin b2 bracket close. One more thing is there, that ideally the relative velocity r1 is equals to the relative velocity r2, means relative velocity at inlet of the blade is equals to relative velocity at outlet of the blade in ideal condition. But we know that when stream glides over the inner surface of the blade, then practically it will develop some friction between the stream and the blade surface. Due to that friction, some part of the energy of a stream will be lost, and due to this reason the relative velocity at outlet of the blade is less than the relative velocity at the inlet of the blade. So the ratio of R2 by R1 is called as friction factor K, which is generally or practically less than 1. Now we will do a small simple numerical question regarding steam flow impulse turbine blade. We can see in the picture there is a blade which is moving in horizontal direction. Steam is issuing from a nozzle with a velocity of 1000 meter per second, and the angle of entrance of steam at the inlet is 19 degree, which is equals to A1. Angle A1 means the angle made by the steam with the horizontal. The blade is moving with velocity 500 meter per second, that is U, and we have to find the power developed over the blade and also the efficiency. In case the value of K is given as 0.89 and the inlet blade angle B1 is equals to the outlet blade angles, which is a condition of equiangular blade, which is a general case for impulse turbine blade. First of all, we have to find the value of R1. We are given with C1 and angle A1. Here R1 is the relative velocity at inlet. So C1 is 1000 meter per second, it is given. So by the help of the formula, we are getting the R1 as 551 meter per second. Similarly, we will get the value of angle B1, which is the inlet blade angle, as 36 degree. Also, the value of K is given 0.89. It means R2 upon R1 is 0.89. So by the help of this thing, we will get the value of R2, which is coming out 490 meter per second. Here R2 is the relative velocity at outlet. Now we are knowing all the variables which are required for getting the power developed over the blade. So by putting the value of R2 and the blade angles B1 and B2, and B1 and B2 are equal, it is given equiangular, so we can keep B1 in place of B2 in the formula. Similarly, we are also knowing the mass flow rate, that is 4 kg per second, which is the amount of steam flowing through the blade per second. So putting all the variables, we are getting the value of power, which is 1684 kilowatt. Now again, we are knowing the formula of efficiency, that is 2P by M dot C1 square. So by putting the values, we are getting the efficiency of blade to be 84%. So by this way, we can find out the efficiency of the blade of simple numerical questions. Simply, we have to find out the value of R1, and then we have to find the value of R2 in case K is given. In case K is not given, then we have to assume that R2 equals to R1, which is an ideal case. Similarly, we can find the value of V1 and B2, which are the inlet and outlet blade angles, and by keeping all the values in the formula, we will get the value of power as well as the value of efficiency.